Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
Welcome to worship with St. John's. Welcome to you in the sanctuary. Welcome to you online, and a special welcome to guests with us on this morning. We've come for this hour of worship because the Holy Spirit has made us all children of God through Jesus Christ. We are united in Christ, and coming for worship helps us to be the church all week long. Since last fall, we've been worshiping under some specific guidelines in the sanctuary here, and with some significant news this week from the CDC and from Rock County, we'll be adapting our worship guidelines. Effective immediately, we will discontinue advanced reservation and assigned seating for worship. Now, I still hope you plan in advance to come for worship, but you can come spur of the moment now. We also plan to follow the CDC's guidelines for wearing of masks. Other changes will come step by step, and we ask your grace and patience. Hand washing, health, self-assessment are still good things for us to do. And while these are exciting steps for many, they are scary steps for others, so we'll walk together with kindness and grace as best as we can. We continue to pray for our health officials and for the sick and the grieving and the vulnerable, especially our siblings around the world. This is our seventh and final week in the season of Easter and in our sermon series, Full of the Spirit. We focused on the third person of the Trinity during this season, the Holy Spirit, who the Holy Spirit is and what the Holy Spirit does. In today's scripture reading, we'll hear how God supplies us with the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit bonds us together in Christ. Next Saturday, May 22nd, you're invited for a hike at the Arboretum on the west side of Janesville. We'll meet at 10 a.m. in the St. John's parking lot. It's a great way to connect with God, connect with others, be out in nature. Next weekend also, weather permitting, we'll have worship outdoors for the Sunday services, 9 a.m. service for all, and then particularly that 10:30 service will be a celebration of our confirmands, the affirmation of baptism. It's also Pentecost next weekend, so you can wear red for the Holy Spirit. So again, 5 p.m. Saturday is in the sanctuary, 9 a.m. on the field, 10:30 a.m. on the field. You can also bring your lawn chair, by the way, for on the field. You can also worship from your vehicle. The sound is plentiful outside, so you can stay in your vehicle, or you could just set up a lawn chair on the parking lot if you don't want to walk onto the field. Sunday, June 6th is our baccalaureate celebration, so we'll bless our graduates, both high school and college and advanced degree graduates. If you know someone who is graduating from college or getting an advanced degree, let the church office know right away. We'd love to include them in that celebration. Thursday, June 10th, we're heading to the ballpark. We're going to go see the Mallison Mallards play. It's $22 a ticket. Your RSVP is due very soon, by May 25th in the church office, $22 a ticket. Or you can talk to Becca Poock. We've got our date confirmed. You all happen to know the soloist of the national anthem, by the way, on that day. I won't tell you who it is. You can just take a guess. And it's going to be a great day. We'll be outside, out at the ballpark, and it includes supper as well. Game time is 6:05 p.m. Be a great chance to get outside together. Our noisy offering is going to ELCA Good Gifts for honeybees, and we have a variety of local honey products available for you to purchase. It's all on the ministry table in the back. There's local honey, there's lip balm, there's honey soap, all sorts of things. Just go back to the table. There's an envelope for you there, and you can support that noisy offering because a portion of the proceeds to the product will also go to the noisy offering as well. So get your local honey, and we'll promote honeybees around the world. The Blue Epistle has other announcements, events, prayers in our life together. Also see your St. John's email news for those things. One last announcement. We'll celebrate Holy Communion together this morning. At that time, come forward, open your hands to receive the bread. We also have gluten-free bread available. And then pick up the cup of wine or juice, which is in the center of the tray. And then you can head back to your seat. An empty basket at the end of the front row is for your empty cup. All are welcome to participate in that holy meal. If you would rather, come forward and cross your arms to receive a blessing. For you who are worshiping online, we invite you to have a form of bread and wine or juice available and join us in that meal of Holy Communion. I invite you to please rise as we give thanks for the gift of baptism. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism.
We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight.
Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your Son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise to the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let's join together. This is the feast.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Power, riches, wisdom, and strength, and honor, blessings, and glory are His. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Sing with all the people of God and join in the hymn of all creation. Blessing, honor, glory, and might be to God. For our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. For the Lamb who was slain has begun his reign. Alleluia. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We worship God the Creator who brings new life from death.
All of creation is full of the Spirit.
We worship Jesus Christ who rose from the dead as Lord of all.
We, the Church, are full of the Spirit.
We worship the Holy Spirit, who gives us life and breath.
We seek to live lives full of the Spirit.
Let us join together in prayer. Loving God, you gather us together as your beloved children in all our differences. Inspire us to honor the diversity of your people while living together as one Church and one holy community. Fill us each day with the Holy Spirit,
and empower us by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please be seated. And for our mission and ministry moment, we're going to hear from, I think, five of our confirmands this morning, sharing their faith with us. Tatum and Spike, come on up. We'll have you go first.
A way that I've seen God in the world is through the rain. The rain can come in both powerful ways, such as a big thunderstorm, or it can be very gentle like a soft sprinkle. In many ways, this reminds me of God's love. It can come in both big loads a lot of the times, but there's also those times when you just need that little push that God provides for us. The rain a lot of the time can get overlooked and forgotten. This happens a lot with God's love. We as humans can overlook God and how loving and forgiving he can be. This doesn't stop God, though. He showers us with love and grace, making us whole and new. The rain does the same for the earth and its plants. When it rains, the plants on earth are washed clean of the dirt that was previously on them and become full of what they need to survive. All in all, the rain can be overlooked, but it will always be there for us when the earth needs it the most, just like God will always be there for us. And like a plant that doesn't get water, we simply could not survive without him.
Amen. Andrew Moran, come on up, Andrew.
I see God in my life and in the world by worshiping him every day, praying to God about my problems and my accomplishments. I'm comforted that my family in heaven watches over me. I have faith that God is always there for me.
Amen. Thanks, Andrew. Isabel Nellen.
I see God in my family and my friends. I see God in my family when they are helping me through things, whether it's helping me with a math problem or helping me through rough times. I know that they are doing it out of love. I see God in my friends when they find the positive in the negative. Thank you.
Amen. Brock Elliott.
I see God in my life when I have hard decisions to make. I feel like God helps me sway my decisions to the choice that will help me better. Also, the better choice that will make me happier in the end. However, sometimes I go against making the better choice, and it usually ends up in not good things. However, sometimes I go against making the better... when I am feeling well, when I'm not feeling well, I will pray, and most of the time, I will feel better not long after. Without listening to what God is trying to tell me, I feel I wouldn't be here where I am right now. I know God is a large reason for all the good in my life.
Amen. And Andrew Wickersham.
I believe God is an image multiple people look at and think of as a motivational prospect. This makes God have a positive outlook because he is a creator of magnificent things. Jesus is a son of God who was sent down to then make history never forgotten. Now that he was a healer, people look up to him and try to follow his ways because he was a perfect human being. Faith is what makes thoughts into good decisions. My faith is what has made me either make other people feel good by going out of my way and making them feel better in different ways. Church is very important to me because once you get closer to your faith and holiness, you start to question mistakes made by you and other people. Once you gather what has happened negatively, you will try to fix it. After confirmation, I will try to pass on my faith either to friends or family so they can gain knowledge of having a good heart. I feel that everyone can make a change, so I'm not going to give up on people. Since I feel people have the ability to exceed, I can coach people to become closer to God.
Amen. Today's scripture is from the book of Galatians, the third chapter. Now, Galatians is a letter which comes from Paul. And Paul was the one who founded this group of churches in Galatia. And Galatia is in what is today central Turkey. So Paul founded this church, was a leader in this community, and then went away for a time, founding other churches around the Eastern Mediterranean. And then other early Christians came to the community and started teaching as well and taught something very different from Paul. Think back to Acts that we looked at a couple of weeks ago in this sermon series. There was this big question over whether Gentiles, that is non-Jewish people, needed to follow Jewish laws and customs in order to be a part of the community. Circumcision, particularly for males, was one of the big debates at the center of this conference at Jerusalem that we thought about a couple of weeks ago. Well, this is the issue here again, is that apparently that council didn't solve all of the issues, and Paul, whose message was that all people are welcome in the church regardless of their ethnic identity, regardless of what they did or who they were, was being contradicted by these new teachers who suggested that these Jewish laws and customs did in fact need to be followed, including by the people in Galatia, who were Gentiles, who were not Jewish themselves. Paul writes this letter to the Galatians and is extremely angry. This is a letter which is famous for Paul's anger at the community for the way that they have been following teachings that are not his own. You'll hear some of that anger in Scripture today. So hear the words of Scripture from the book of Galatians, chapter 3. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly exhibited and crucified. The only thing I want to learn from you is this. Did you receive the Spirit by doing the works of the law or by believing what you have heard? Are you so foolish? Having started with the Spirit, are you now ending with the flesh? Did you experience so much for nothing, if it really was for nothing? Well then, does God supply you with the Spirit and work miracles among you by your doing the works of the law or by you believing what you heard? Just as Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, so you see, those who believe are descendants of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, declared the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the Gentiles shall be blessed in you. For this reason, those who believe are blessed with Abraham who believed. Now, before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith.
As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, God, our strength and redeemer. Amen. So here we are in Galatians having this argument yet again about whether churches that are full of Gentiles, full of non-Jewish people, need to follow Jewish law. When we talk about Jewish law, I think it can be easy for us to think of it as law as we would think of it in America today, things that we have to follow, things that are enforced by the government. And that really was not the case in the time and place that we are talking about here. The government of Jewish people and the early Christian community that was following these Jewish laws was not a Jewish government itself. It didn't care about these laws. These were cultural customs, traditions, expectations, certainly, within the community, but not enforced by any legal structures. So really, when we're thinking about this early Christian community and the earliest Christian community, which is following these Jewish laws and customs, the laws and customs that were followed by Jesus, that were followed by Jesus' disciples, which were followed by Paul, who is writing this letter to the Galatians. Following the law is a badge of belonging to the Jewish community. It's an identification with a particular culture in the Eastern Mediterranean. So following the law is in part about a particular ethnic identity. The teachers, the early Christian teachers who were opposing Paul here, were saying that the Galatians, these Gentiles, people who weren't a member of this culture, that they needed to become a part of this culture. They needed, in fact, to physically change their appearance, to look like people in this culture, abandon their previous ethnic identity, to become like the Jewish culture that Jesus, his disciples, and Paul himself followed. And remember again, this is an old argument, an argument that we heard about in Acts, an argument that has been really at the core of a lot of the disagreements in the church in this early Christian period. Do we have to, as a Christian community, be a part of a very particular culture and follow a particular set of laws and customs? Well, Paul has been very clear about this from the beginning, and we heard about Paul being clear about this in Acts as well, that the Gentiles do not need to be ethnically Jewish because the Spirit came to them, just like the Spirit came to the Jewish community, that the Spirit came to all people, Gentile and Jew. And because the Spirit came and came to all people, we know that we are all enough just as who we are, no matter who we are or what community we come from. It's important to notice, too, that this argument is about how people are coming to the church as members of particular cultures, because Paul himself, as he discusses in other places, follows the law himself. His problem isn't with the law itself. And God's promises are still applying through the promises given to Abraham. He says that throughout the book of Galatians today, that the promises of Abraham were because Abraham believed and God reckoned it to Abraham as righteousness. And so those who are part of Abraham's community doesn't have to do with their physical appearance. It has to do with their faith. So then we get to this really, I think, incredibly beautiful verse, one that's very well known in our church. one I'm sure is very familiar to many of you, in Galatians 3:28. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. No longer Jew or Greek, no longer slave or free, no longer male and female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. I think this is a beautiful verse, one that I have always found to be really meaningful, one that actually probably predates Paul. We gave thanksgiving for baptism earlier in service. We had a baptism here last night, and this verse is likely from a very early form of Christian baptism, something that was said at the baptism of new believers. Well, what does this mean? What does this mean to Paul? What should it mean to us? I think often we think that this verse is about all of us being the same. This we are, all of you are one in Christ Jesus. We're all one in Christ Jesus. It can feel like that means we're all the same, that our differences are eliminated, or even that we should ignore our differences. But in the context of Paul's letter to the Galatians here, that interpretation doesn't actually make a lot of sense. Because this whole letter, Paul is trying to show that people do not need to be the same. That the Gentile community in Galatia does not need to look and act like the Jewish Christian community in Jerusalem, to be a part of the Christian community. The Galatians don't need to be like the other people, even like Paul himself. They can be who they are and be full and complete members of the church. So what is it about then, if it's not about all of us being the same? I would say that it's about liberation. Because when we think about these binaries in this verse, Jew, Greek, slave, free, male, female, I think we can often think about this as a sort of horizontal spectrum. But in the ancient mindset, these are not just, or they aren't even necessarily, opposites. But rather, their power structures. To the ancient mindset, there would have been no question that being free was better than being a slave. In a patriarchal, very patriarchal society, that being male was better than being female. And the whole argument at the center of Galatians is being Jewish better than being Greek? So there is a power dynamic at play here, beyond just difference. When I was at Divinity School, I had a really wonderful professor named Brad Braxton, and he wrote this great book. It's called No Longer Slaves, Galatians and the African American Experience. He's an African American professor. And I'm gonna read for you just a couple of sentences from his book about this verse, about Galatians 3:28. Dr. Braxton said that Paul is not asserting the obliteration of difference, but the obliteration of dominance. When one enters the Christian community through belief in Christ and baptism, one does not necessarily lose the ethnic, social, or gender distinctions that have characterized one's existence. Even in Christ, there is still human difference. The dominance of one over the other based on these differences is the reality that is abolished. Christ, Braxton says, has liberated believers not from the tyranny of difference, but from the tyranny of sameness. So let's think about what that means for us here in community today. You know, I was thinking very particularly about something that I did yesterday. Yesterday morning, my wife and I went to Stoughton to celebrate Sitten de Mai. It was my wife's first Sitten de Mai, not my first. My family is Norwegian and have celebrated Sitten de Mai for a long time, and I'm seeing from some nods and knowing you all well enough to know that some of you celebrate it too. And it's great. It's a wonderful celebration of my and many of your Norwegian heritage. It's a great time to celebrate a little bit of our history and our families. But, so this is what we're getting at here with this verse, is that being a Christian does not then mean that I'm not Norwegian, or that being Norwegian is not something for me to celebrate. But what it does mean is that me being Norwegian does not make me better than anybody else in our community, even if sometimes we make some Swedish jokes. We can celebrate our diversity, we can celebrate our differences, as long as those differences don't then lead to dominance. For Paul, ethnicity, Jew or Greek, economic status, slave or free, gender, male or female, were key markers of domination in his time. And I know that you all could think of key markers of domination here in our time, some of which would certainly be different than his time, and sadly, some of which maybe aren't so different from his time. And so I want to invite you, take a minute, think about what are some of those markers of domination that we could write about in a letter to ourselves, in our society. Domination, things, binaries, divisions that divide us in terms of domination. And I want to invite you to think about that. Take a minute and think to yourself about some examples that you could think of. I asked you to think about these structures of power in our society. And those structures of power in our society walk through those church doors. And they take place here in our churches as well. Too often, we want people to act like us. We want people to think like us. We even want people to look like us. Exactly those problems that Paul is so mad about in the book of Galatians, in his letter. Too often we want this. Many of you here, many of you watching online, can remember a time in the ELCA, in this church, when women were not allowed to be pastors, where their calling was not respected as men's were. And almost all of you will remember a time, because it's only been a decade since our national church body affirmed the beauty and the holiness of LGBT people in our church. These differences are important. We should celebrate the human diversity that walks through those doors every single Sunday. And we should challenge. We should fight when people are treated differently, are put into structures of domination of race, gender, sexuality, economic status, or any of the other things that you thought about earlier in this sermon. We should challenge when difference leads to domination, knowing that we are all God's beloved children, and our difference should rather lead to celebration. That's what we hear in Scripture today. In Christ, it is not our differences, but our sinful domination, which is eliminated Life is better. Better when our differences are celebrated together, not hidden, not used to dominate. Let me give you an example of this. I'm going to invite some folks forward to help me with this. And we're going to take a piece of Galatians 3:28, what we just read, and we are going to be singing it for you. You can go ahead whenever you're ready.
Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more.
All right. Great singers. They sound good. They're all singing the same note. All coming at the same place, coming at the same note, thinking the same thing. But what happens if we all come to it from different notes? What happens if we come to it not all as sopranos, but as sopranos, alters, tenors, basses, all of the places that our voices actually should naturally be?
Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more.
Beautiful. Our voices are more rich, are more interesting, are more spirit-filled when they join together on different notes, on the notes where we as people would more naturally fall. So, what does this mean for being spirit-filled in the church? Well, I think it means that we should all bring our full selves to the church. When you come through those doors, be who you are. And know that you will encounter others who are singing different notes and even other tunes. And you should be ready to have parts of you changed as your voice joins in harmony with others. Filled with the Holy Spirit, I believe that we will create beautiful music together, proclaiming from floor to rafter that all are welcome in this place. Amen.
One we claim.
Let us build a house where love is found in water, wine, and meat. A banquet hall on holy ground where peace and justice meet. Hear the love of God through Jesus is revealed in time and space. As we share in Christ the feast that frees us, all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build
Living together in trust and hope, let us now confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Together we'll pray for the church, the world, and all those in need according to our requests. For whom and for what shall we pray together today? The conflict in Israel-Palestine. Let us pray. O Holy Spirit, you bring peace to our hearts and our homes and our communities and our world. And we ask for you to advance the peace process in Israel and Palestine. We pray, God, that you would protect lives, that you would comfort those who mourn and grieve, that you'd give wisdom to world leaders and work for justice and compassion there. We pray for a peaceful and harmonious solution. Lord, in your mercy. Yep, for the health of younger children in this pandemic environment, let's pray. Oh, Holy Spirit, we ask that you continue to guide our health officials and healthcare workers in this time of changes in the pandemic. God, we pray for your protection, particularly over our children. God, we pray that they would get the health care that they need, that all people would get the health care that they need. Lord, in your mercy. Yeah. For churches around the world, wonderful. Let's pray. Oh, Holy Spirit, we thank you for the church in this world. We thank you how you bring diverse people together to be united in Jesus Christ. We pray, God, that you would continue to strengthen the church around the world. Fill the church with love that we can't help but overflow with your love for all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all those who share their talents of voice, arts, dance, and more, let's give thanks. Let's pray. Oh, Holy Spirit, we thank you for the many gifts that you give to each one of us. God, we pray that you would continue to raise up gifts in us and help us to know our gifts. We especially thank you for the gifts of art and music and dance and creativity. God, continue to help us be curious about your world and ourselves and to share our creativity. Lord, in your mercy, our prayer. And we'll end with our prayer commitments.
Holy Spirit, we come to you for healing in body, mind, and soul, in whatever ways you know that we need. We especially lift up to you these members of our church: Sandy, Katrina, Marjorie, Michael, Fran, Margie, Rose, Jean, Charlie, Lynn, Sam, Pauline, Sue, Ken, Janet, Shirley, Denise, Ben, and Jenna. Wrap your loving arms around us all and show us how to love one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Christ Jesus, head of the church, raise up pastors to preach your word and administer your sacraments, deacons to serve all people and bear your gospel to the world, and congregational leaders to bring vision and vitality to your people. Grant us in the grace to identify those in our midst you are calling, courage to their name, gifts, and opportunities to gently nurture your people and support their discernment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray now in silence for our families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive all our prayers, those spoken and those on our hearts. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we might rise to new life and do you will, by the power of our risen Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
We invite you to share your prayer request with us. You can do that on Facebook. You can do that through our website. And it is time for our children's message. So my young friends, come on up. Come join me up here. If you have a noisy offering, you can bring that too. We're bringing noisy offering to buy honeybees around the world. And even though honeybees might be a little scary to us, we need honeybees. And remember, there's all those honeybee products out in the gathering area also. Come on up, friends. Come on up. Good to see you this morning. Good, good, good. All right. Anyone else? Come on up. All right. Here they come. Well, I brought a whole bag of some wonderful things, and I'm going to see if you like them too. All right. So first thing I brought is I brought a box of Cheerios. I like Cheerios. Raise your hand if you like Cheerios. I like Cheerios. Cheerios are good to eat. They're yummy, made of 100% whole grain oats. Really good. All right. Well, I brought some more things. Let's see, I brought M&Ms. Raise your hand if you like M&Ms. Out there, anybody like M&Ms? All right, we like M&Ms, right? Chocolate candies with a nice, colorful coating, right? Very good. Don't eat too many, though, not at one time, right? Okay, how about what else do I have in here? I got, what are these?
Raisins.
Raisins, who likes raisins? Might not be as popular as the M&Ms, but I like raisins, too. Raisins are really, they're good for us, sun-dried raisins. All right, here we go, and I got one more thing. What do I got? What is it? Yep, dry roasted peanuts. Who likes peanuts? Now, some people are allergic to peanuts, so I'm going to keep this closed. Do not worry. If you are allergic to peanuts, I'm going to keep it closed, all right? Well, these are all great foods, right? Each one of them is really good, right on their own. I would eat any one of them, right? Good. They're good. You know, they're very different from each other. Some are sweet and some are salty. One's a fruit and one's made from grains. They're all very different. You know, they're all good, but they're all very different. Well, when we bring them together, have you ever mixed them together? We call it gorp. I got a picture of it up on the screen. Gorp, or a trail mix. Yeah, say gorp. Gorp, that's what I call it. And I mix them all together, and let me tell you, it is really good. Like, it is so good that I can barely stop eating it. Like, I could eat it all day long, I think. Gorp, it's really good. So I would highly recommend it. Each one of these things, different on its own, you bring it together, and it makes something really good. Well, friends, that's a lot like the church. The church is kind of like GORP. Look around in this room. We have very different people. And this is just some of the church. This is just a small pocket of the church. The church, every one person in the church is different and wonderful and unique. And when you bring all these people together, it's wonderful. It's more wonderful than you'd ever imagine it could be. Because we all bring what's different and we all come together in love. We all come together in Jesus Christ, and it is so good. God has made each one of us wonderful and unique, and the Holy Spirit brings us all together to be a great community of love. And that's the church, a great community of love. That's why I love the church so much. I can barely get enough of the church. I love it that much. And you're all a part of it, and we need you. All right, friends, thanks for coming up. You can stand up and face out to our family and friends, and we're going to share the peace. And put your arms out wide, and let's say it together. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's still turn to our neighbors and share a sign of peace with one another. Just going for that. We invite you to give an offering to the mission and ministry of St. John's. You can do that in a variety of ways, through the mail, through our drop box on the front porch, online. And for those here in the sanctuary, there's an offering box in the gathering area. The Holy Spirit calls us to be generous disciples of Jesus Christ. Let's rise as we praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and
in thanksgiving for the gift of our lives, our offering shared, and the meal we are about to receive, let us pray. God of abundance, you give us all good things and fill us with your Spirit. Grant us glad and generous hearts to serve our neighbors. Teach us to live in tune with your Holy Spirit, so that all the earth may know of your goodness and grace. Offered through the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
On the night you were betrayed, you took the bread. After giving thanks, you broke it and said,
"This is my body, broken for you, and as you eat it, remember me. This is my body, broken for you, and as you eat it, remember me."
On the night you were betrayed, you held the cup. After giving thanks, you lifted it up.
This is my blood poured out for you. And as you drink it, remember me. This is my blood poured out for you. And as you drink it, remember me.
So we thank you for the wine and for the bread. For we see the life you gave and the blood you shed.
And we remember your wondrous love. You gave your body, you shed your blood. And we remember your wondrous love. You gave your body, you shed your
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The table is set. Christ is the host. Come as you are. Please be seated. For you who are worshiping online, take the bread. This is the body of Christ given for you. And take the cup. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Thank you. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. God of new life, through this meal you fill our hearts with gladness. Satisfy the hunger still around us and send us as joyful witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The blessing of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, surround and sustain you, keep you from harm, and fill you with courage to do God's will.
Amen.
Our sending song for the end of our Easter season is Christ is Alive, Let Christians Sing.
Christ is alive, let Christians sing. The cross stands empty to the sky. Let streets and
is alive, no longer bound to distant tears in Palestine, but saving, healing here and now, and touching every place and time. In every insult, drift, and war, where colors scorn or wealth divide, Christ suffers still, yet loves all more, and lives where even hope has died. Women and men in age and youth can feel the Spirit, hear the call, and find the way, the life and truth revealed in Jesus' free glory.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good timing.